Greetings, my name is Monty Martin, and welcome back to Isadora 101. In this series of video workshops, I'm going to be introducing you to the core features and functionality of Isadora 3. Today, we are getting ready for showtime, and we are going to learn how to get our computer and Isadora ready for final video output to an audience so they can see all the awesome things that we've created with Isadora. Now, this is part 1A of a two-part series. Today, I'm going to be talking to you about how to best configure your computer's display settings on Mac OS. I'm also going to do a video version of this video for you Windows users out there. And then in part 2, I'll be showing you, whether you are on Mac or PC, how to configure stage setup in Isadora. All these steps are really important and completely necessary to optimize your computer and Isadora to show the best visual image possible for your show. Now, before we dive in too deeply, I want to cover a few bits of terminology first. Many designers use Isadora to output video to a digital projector for live theater, but that doesn't always have to be the case. Instead, we use the term display as a catch-all to refer to any piece of physical hardware which can receive digital video input and present that to the world. This might be a digital video projector, which we like to call a beamer, or it could be a computer monitor, a television set, or any other piece of digital video equipment. Now, to follow along today, it's actually best if you do have a secondary display which you can connect your computer to. Whether you're working on a desktop computer or a laptop computer, your machine is going to have the primary display that you work with and the secondary displays that you're going to be connected to. To follow along best today, you're going to want to have one of those secondary displays available, and you're going to want to make sure that you have all of the other connectivity bits that you're going to need to plug that into your machine. In my case, I'm using one of these digital AV adapters for my Mac computer. It goes from USB-C to VGA, and I've got my VGA cable that I'm going to run into my projector as well. I'm going to plug these in together, and I'm going to plug these into the USB-C ports on my laptop. So if your computer does not have an HDMI port or a VGA port, you might need an adapter like this. There have been a lot of different ones made for Macs over the years, ones that connect with Thunderbolt, USB-C, DisplayPort, and more. They range in price, and honestly, I have so many of these, I'm tripping over them whenever I open up my computer closet. But they always come in handy, and you never want to be without one, especially when you're going to a gig, because if you don't know what the projector is you're going to be working with, you might not know what adapter you're going to need to connect to. Whether you're working at home, in your studio, or in a theater, when you are connecting computers to displays, test everything first, on the ground, in a neutral environment. Don't wait until the projector has been installed in your grid, or in a ceiling, or in some sort of rig. Cabling has been run, people had to get up on ladders to do it, only to find out that one of these adapters is faulty, or the cable isn't long enough, or most commonly, the projector has some really weird settings loaded into it, and you need to make changes to it, but unfortunately, now the projector has been pointed at your irregular surface that you're going to projection map onto, and you can't see the options in the menu on the projector. So I always, as a best practice, set my projector up on the floor, pointed at a clear wall where I can very, very, very clearly see what is on that display. I plug it into my laptop and I configure everything first. Once that is all done, and particularly if you've plugged your laptop and projector in using the same cables and the same ports, your computer will remember the settings that you had previously. So you can connect everything on the ground, label everything, including the ports that you're connecting to on the computer, and if it is all reinstalled in the same order, these settings will be preserved. It's when you set things up on the floor and then don't plug things in the same way once they're actually installed that you run into problems and then are right back to square one and you have to reconfigure everything again. Furthermore, once you are all ready to go, I always recommend a certain order of operations when we're working with Isadora, again, whether we're in the design phases or before a show. Always begin by connecting your display and your computer to each other physically before either device is powered on. Then power up the display and then power up your computer. Once everything has booted up, you'll want to follow along with the steps that we're going to do next in this video to get everything configured properly. If you've already done that, you can go ahead and launch Isadora. The key thing to make sure of is that the computer and the projector have detected each other and the signal is moving from your computer to your projector before Isadora is launched. This will help you troubleshoot any problems in your connection chain. In most cases, it is very unlikely that if you are not seeing output from Isadora on your projector, that it is a problem with Isadora itself. In 99% of the cases, the issue is usually something is not plugged in or set up properly somewhere along the physical chain from the projector to the computer itself. By making sure Isadora is the last thing to come online, you can make sure that 99% of your problems are covered and you know that the connection has been established successfully. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. I'm going to power down my computer and everything, and I am going to plug everything in together, and we'll come back and see where we're at in just a moment. With a flicker, my laptop and my projector are connected. Right now, my laptop and the projector are working together in what is called display mirroring mode. What this means is that what I see on the screen of my laptop is identical to what is output to the display of the projector itself. This is very ideal if we are delivering a lecture or a PowerPoint presentation to an audience where we want to show them exactly what we are seeing on our screen. But when we're working with Isadora, that's actually not the case. Typically, when we are running our show, we will want to see the control screen so that we can monitor what is happening in our show, see what cues are coming up next, and make sure if we need to make any adjustments, we can do that. But then we will want to show the audience something completely different, the output that is meant for them to see. Because of this, we need to switch our Mac computer off of display mirroring mode and onto what is called extended desktop mode. To do this, we're going to click the Apple logo up here in the top corner of our screen and go to System Preferences. You can also launch your System Preferences from the launch pad. This is the fastest way to find it in Mac OS. Then we are going to go to the second row here in the first column called Displays. This opens up our Display Preferences and allows us to change the settings of how the resolution and presentation of all the displays connected to our computer are going to operate. The most important thing that I want to do at this stage is click the Arrangement tab. You'll notice that right now, this option for mirror displays is checked off, and my displays are shown here in a little stack. I'm going to uncheck this option to disable mirroring right now. Okay, with just a flicker, and this is the result. I can now see my laptop operating at full resolution, and my projector is showing something different but similar to what is on the main display of my computer. Now the two displays are operating in extended desktop mode. This means that I can use both of them discreetly rather than needing to show the same thing on each display. This is exactly what we want when we're going to be working on our designs and operating Isadora. When things are working this way, I can click each display to identify them very quickly. You'll notice that when I do this, a flashing red bar appears along the borders of the screen so I can tell which is which. And I want to make sure that this white bar, which indicates the primary display, is associated with the primary display of my computer. If I need to change this, you can just click this and drag it and move it onto the screen that is your primary display. In my case, this is correct, so I'm going to leave it as it is. You may also be tempted to rearrange these displays, as macOS recommends, so that they correspond to their position in the real world. I recommend that you do not do this. Well, it might make sense for your brain to have the display at the bottom or the top or on the right-hand side or the left-hand side. I recommend arranging your displays from left to right in sequential order. This is best for performance when working with Isadora and also helps your computer keep everything organized. If you rearrange things and are moving your mouse pointer in various directions, it's easy for the computer to get a little bit confused, especially when things are getting unplugged and plugged back in. Arrange them left to right in order 1, 2, 3 if you are using multiple displays. In this case, I just have the one display, so I'm just going to leave it to the right of my main display. Now that I have switched mirroring off, I've only got a few more things that I will want to do before I'm ready to work with Isadora itself. I may need to change the resolution, not of my main laptop screen, but of my secondary display. So if you do need to change the rotation or the refresh rate or scale the resolution to a different option, all those are available by accessing the preferences that are actually shown on the output of the projector itself. This is another really good reason why it's best to configure your projector when it's on the floor and not when it's installed on the roof, so that you can very easily see these options on your screen itself. Although I'm going to leave this to the defaults for my display, I'm happy with everything here. Now I'm going to click back here on my system preferences because there's a few more things that I want to check on before I'm ready to go. If you are noticing the menu bar of Mac OS appearing on both your main display and your secondary display, you have one important thing that you need to disable, and that is found in Mission Control. That is the option for Displays Have Separate Spaces. When this is enabled or checked, you will see the menu bar and the dock appear on every single one of your displays that are connected to your Mac. This is not ideal when we're working with Isadora because the menu bar will appear superimposed over the output from Isadora. So we need to disable this by unchecking the option Displays Have Separate Spaces. The next thing that you will want to change before we wrap up today is found in your desktop and screensaver options. And that is actually changing the desktop background of your computer from whatever it currently is to the colors to a flat black. And I would recommend doing this on both the main display of your computer and going over and changing this on your output display as well. Why do I recommend this? Well, performance is always filled with unexpected surprises. Sometimes displays can accidentally get unplugged. Sometimes Isadora can actually accidentally be quit, or the stages might be hidden, or something just might go wrong and you might need to stop a queue unexpectedly, and the fastest way to do it is to just shut down Isadora entirely. When this happens, it's best if your output defaults to a plain black output rather than any fancy or quirky desktop background that you might have on your computer or your output display. So I recommend changing this just as an extra little security net in case something does go wrong or the unexpected happens. That way, there's a flat black that you can retreat to when things go wrong. Many projectors as well, when they become unplugged, default to a blue screen of death, but many newer projectors actually allow you to change the color of this no signal screen to a flat black as well. So I encourage you to check out the settings of your projector and see if this option is available to you as well, because if something gets unplugged, which is probably one of the worst case scenarios that can happen in the midst of a performance, that way even the projector itself won't show a blue screen of death, which is a clear sign to an audience that something has gone wrong. Well, with that, once we've configured our display options, disabled separate spaces in Mission Control, and changed our desktop background, we've pretty much got everything ready to go. One of the only other things that you may want to check on before you wrap things up is under your energy saver preferences, and you may want to make sure that both automatics graphics switching is disabled if that option is available. This just ensures that Isadora is always using the high performance dedicated graphics card on your Mac. And finally, you may also want to make sure that your options for turning off or putting your computer to sleep are disabled or set to several hours or longer. You can find this in your energy saver preferences. And you may also want to go back into desktop and screensaver and simply disable your screensaver entirely as well. This will just make sure that if something is idle, perhaps if you have a really long queue in your show that is 15 minutes long and the operator is kind of having a bit of a snooze, that way your screens don't accidentally go black or your computer doesn't accidentally go to sleep or a screensaver doesn't actually accidentally pop up. It's really important as well that you don't have your computer set to have a screensaver show up after only 1 or 2 minutes. So check on those last couple of things before you wrap things up, and you should be good to go with working with Isadora in any sort of performance setting. That about wraps it up for the options that we want to configure on our Mac computer before we start configuring Isadora. So I'm going to close this down, and I'm going to get ready to power up Isadora. I'm going to see you in part 2 of this tutorial, where we're going to launch Isadora, and we are going to configure our stage setup for final display output. We'll see you at the next workshop.